It's the fastest racing track in the world. The high banks and wide open surface invite speed. It's Michigan International Speedway, home of the Michigan 500. But increased speed in close racing can spell disaster. At 230 miles an hour, reactions must be instinctive. Even the slightest hesitation can turn a beautiful run into a terrifying ride. A driver's perfect day can end not just by his own mistakes, but by those of others. The concrete wall streams along, inches away, almost inviting. But even the slightest touch is devastating. Last year, the Michigan 500 was a contest of youth. Paul Tracy battled with Scott Goodyear in a duel that went on for miles. And ended with Scott Goodyear's first IndyCar win. Now they're back. Paul Tracy with three wins this year, the hottest driver in the series. Raul Boisel, third in points. Skilled, consistent, searching for a win. Englishman Nigel Mansell, second in points, and chasing the new points leader, Emerson Fittipaldi. The race for the PPG Cup is flat out. Speedway, it's the 13th running of the Michigan 500. Hello, I'm Paul Page, and in many ways, this is IndyCar racing's toughest day. Unlike Indianapolis with its long straightaways, on this 2 mile high bank speedway, two thirds of the lap, you're turning the car, and the G forces are trying to push you out of the cockpit. And consider two awesome speeds over 230 miles an hour, and a terrific front row, Ford powered Lola chassis. A great veteran and a great rookie. Here's Jack Arud.
Well, Paul, for the second consecutive year, Newman Haas Racing owns the front row for this Michigan 500. Again, Mario Andretti on the pole with a record-breaking speed. But as he looks to his right on the outside pole position, no, it's not his son Michael like it was last year. It's his teammate Nigel Mansell, a rookie here at Michigan, but so important to Nigel Mansell this qualifying effort because he is still embroiled in a very heated points chase for the National Driving Championship. And for more on his foe, let's check in with my colleague Gary Gerald.
Jack, one of the great surprises of this race weekend has been the search for speed for season points leader Emerson Fittipaldi. He starts back here in 15th position in the eighth row. You've got to go back 6 years to the last time he had a worse qualifying position. But he's with some very interesting company. He's got Bobby Rahal to his immediate right. He's got Allanser Jr. right behind him. Three veteran winning drivers, more than 60 wins between them in their careers, better than 10 miles an hour slower than that front row. They've got a lot of work to do in the 500 miles ahead. Paul?
So very definitely some surprises in the way they line up here for the Michigan 500. An interesting qualifying
session. It's all yours, Rick.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen of the Marlboro 500, start your engines.
Fire, 161 cubic inches, turbocharged engines, developing nearly 800 horsepower. The chassis itself, 1,550 pounds. Composite materials. High tech, high speed, and they are going to be tested here today. In this starting field today, in the chassis, three Penske chassis, the rest are all Lolas. And the engine combinations today, 10 Cosworth, the rest are Chevrolet with the exception of one Buick and one Cosworth DFS. So now they sit
as well.
So now behind the PPG pace car, the field lines up. The points fights in the Indy cars, well, it just changed at the last race. Nigel Mansell has been dominating most of the year, but now Emerson Fittipaldi is in front. You ride with Bobby Rahal as the field begins to align now, coming off of the fourth and final corner and turning toward the green flag. Nicely aligned, but as Mario comes ahead, the green flag does come out. Mario got a good jump on the rest of the field. Nigel Mansell slides into second place, and the rest of the field comes on through. Coming forward to begin to challenge, but here comes Mansell once again. And Mansell moves for second place as he moves very low on the race board. Remember, this is his first start on a super speedway, high bank at this time. And Mario Andretti turns in for the line and takes the first lap, while the battle for second is between Lion Dyke and Mansell. Now Mansell looks to the high side as they head down into turn one. Lion Dyke holds a mid-course line and pulls away from Nigel Mansell. Mario Andretti has now led in 10 of the 13 Michigan 500. Well, there he is, out in front, Mario Andretti, followed by the battle between Lion Dyke and Mansell. Scott Goodyear into fourth. Raul Boisel runs in fifth. In sixth place is Paul Tracy as we follow the Boisel and Tracy story. Seventh across the line, Robbie Gordon, then Brayton, then Tail Bobby and Roberto Guerrero. And Nigel Mansell moves again.
You got to remember, Paul, too, these are all Lola 4s. The two, the Andretti car, the Mansell car, and the red and black one right there, Lion Dyke, all Lola 4s. So the speed should be just about the same. But remember another thing, drafting here will make a lot more difference than it does in a lot of the tracks.
Battle for fourth and fifth, Raul Boisel, Scott Goodyear.
Bobby, I think the key to what you just said is the Ford part. In qualifying, the Ford engines have absolutely dominated. You see Tracy on the right there. He's the front-running Chevrolet.
Well, Paul Tracy closes in on Scott Goodyear. On the Ford engines themselves, Jack Arute has an update. Jack?
Well, Paul, the Ford engines may be having a problem in the telemetry. It seems during the practice session, they did not get all of the telemetry back from the race cars via the radio wave. All the Ford engineers have been working with their laptop computers. They are still not getting an accurate reading of all the items that they should be measuring. So there's a lot of head scratching and a lot of concern for all the Ford teams. Ironically, the only team that's not experiencing the problem is Mario Andretti's Newman Haas team.
Nigel Mansell just blistered off the fastest lap of the race thus far at 221 miles an hour.
Mansell was highly critical of the track after just a few laps around it back on Friday, but he is obviously taking control of this situation despite having so little experience here.
Nothing changes at the front of the field. This is the battle for seventh place. Robbie Gordon is trying to hold off a very lively Scott Brayton.
And Gordon, and there in the black car, has had a terrific mid-season. He's had a 10th. There's Brayton making a move on him, but Gordon has become Mr. Reliable with a 10th, a pair of 8s, and 2 6ths for his last five races going into this. He's starting to take the long view instead of just trying to win every race in the first lap.
Side by side through the third and fourth. Side by side through the tri-oval, they get very close together. And Brayton holds on. Here comes Fittipaldi, closing just behind them. So now it's a three-way battle.
Remember, with two guys running side by side the way Gordon and Scott did, you can just imagine the draft that Fittipaldi was getting from that. It's almost like a vacuum sucking him up to the two of them.
Is it, though, Bobby Unser, a good draft, or is there some turbulence in there that could cause a problem?
No, it's a really good draft, Paul, especially on the straightaways. In the turns, it's going to be a lot of turbulence. He won't like that. But, man, he can back off half the throttle when he's running with him like that.
Following the same battle from the Goodyear blimp floating over Michigan International Speedway here. Michigan International celebrating its 25th anniversary this year. And once again, here comes Brayton. They move to the backstretch. This is where he's been able to get his best run on Gordon.
And again, Fittipaldi slowly begins to inch toward both of them.
Now we think, or at least I think, that Brayton probably could have moved up on Robbie Gordon in the black car a little bit quicker than he did right then. But all of these drivers realize this track is a man killer. They're all going to be desperately tired if they make it to the end.
Remember that Scott Brayton comes from Coldwater, Michigan, very near here, so the stands are packed.
Battle for third now. Tracy, Goodyear.
As I went down to the garages yesterday talking to the various mechanics, a lot of the Chevrolet guys were asking me, do you think the Fords can finish, Bobby? They know that the Fords have a lot more power on them here. And, you know, nobody knows because they haven't done a 500 mile like that. But they are awful fast here.
Tracy using the advantage of the slower car, Kwasuszta just ahead of him. And he tries to get down inside a Goodyear, but it won't work. By the way, the pronunciation on Kwasuszta, that is now how his team says they'd like it used. Here's Tracy just alongside of Scott Goodyear. Uses the draft going into the third turn, but Scott Goodyear is going to hang with him.
This is the battle for third.
And keep in mind, Tracy is in a Chevy, Goodyear is in the fourth.
And remember, it was these two men who battled it out at the end of this race last year. So they have resumed their rivalry here on the high banks of Michigan exactly a year later.
Back at the front of the field, Nigel Mansell has now closed up. Using the traffic on Mario Andretti, he comes way high into the corner, gets alongside Mario. Mario has the better line at this point, but look at Nigel Mansell. This is a rookie on a super speedway. He figured it out in about three laps of practice.
Well, Paul, one thing I've been noticing on Mario, his last or three laps ago was 2:16, then 2:14, his last lap was 2:10. Now, some of that's in traffic, but Nigel has caught him from way back, probably 100 yards back, where now he should pull away. So Mario definitely has some sort of a problem.
Both of them pull high to come through the traffic now. Nigel Mansell picks up the lead here in Michigan for the first time, the first lead change in the race today. 28 laps are complete very shortly. They'll start thinking about the pit stops, but Nigel Roberto Guerrero makes his stop.
One of the things that's happened to the Lola cars, Paul, is the bell housings. The housing between the engine and the transmission was breaking on the Lolas. About 2 weeks ago, it's been rumored that the factory knew that they were having bell housing problems, but they failed to tell all the mechanics. There's Tracy coming in for pit stop.
Let's go to Jackaroo.
And Paul, they make a major adjustment on the front wing, as they also will change all four tires. They took it look to be about a turn up on both the right and the left side of the front wing. Chasing the racetrack all day. Let's check in with Gary Gerrell.
Mario Andretti, the first of the Newman Haas drivers to come in. The man who set the record from the pole, not expecting any changes. Routine stop with fresh rubber and fuel. He's rolling in just under 14 seconds. Now we wait for Mansell.
And Mansell is on the pit road. He turned the last lap before this one at 225 miles an hour. And he turns in toward Gary.
And Paul, he comes in very slowly, being very cautious. Remember, this whole business of many pit stops in a race still somewhat new to Mansell. A very conservative approach. The team going through their usual chores. Again, there'll be no changes here. They talked about
Mansell
a wing change.
Mansell catches a break, Gary. Mansell catches a break. The yellow is out. Stefan Johansson spun it in the fourth turn, got it up against the wall. Safety crews are already there, but Mansell was in the pits as the yellow came out.
Well, this is the thing. It's really going to change things. When you have a yellow coming out on a two-mile track like this under the green flag when everybody's in the pit, boy, I'll tell you what, it's going to cause a lot of rethinking on their pit stops.
Pit speed limit today, 110 miles an hour. They'll give you five. If you get to 115, they're going to stop and go you for a penalty.
Just ahead of him up the road.
Back with the leader, Nigel Mansell, having never raced here at Michigan International Speedway or on any high bank speedway before. We asked Nigel if he'd undergone any kind of special preparation for this race.
I watch film of every single race we go to, and I think the greatest thing that's happened to me before this race is I spent 4 days with a great friend, with Greg Norman and Laura and the children. And, we had a wonderful number of days fishing and messing around. And that's conditioned me pretty good because I got my mind sort of clear of a lot of things, and I've come here totally refreshed now, and hopefully for the next number of races we'll be able to sort of get back really up to speed and then do some good dogfighting.
He enjoys a very special relationship with golfer Greg Norman.
You know, it's almost as if the pressure of leading the championship, which he has done since Long Beach, he led it, of course, by winning the first race, slipped back of Mario Andretti at Phoenix, and then led the whole way until Emerson Fittipaldi notched him. Now he's like back in the fighting Mansell mode, trying to get back in the lead.
Ari Leyendyke and Robbie Gordon, as they battle, Leyendyke's had his problems here today. It is a battle to try and obtain... And beginning to wave him down. Remember, he had problems at Indy with these high-speed pit stops. Let's go to Gary.
They're changing stagger on Mario's car as he gets away in about 15 seconds. Now Nigel is in.
Whoa.
No problem as they went out between
Mario
these two.
Mario spun coming off the pit.
Oh,
he's
Mario
now reversed.
Right in front of us.
Mario spins it around again. Whoa!
He keeps it running, Paul. And the crowd is going crazy because he kept it running. Now Mansell, who had a good look at it, leaves.
Now let me tell you.
Slower.
Wait a minute. I want to tell you that was spectacular.
Yes, it was, Paul. Now that was a good piece of driving. That was a good piece of thinking. Don't ever think that Mario's over the hill when he can think and react that quick.
Remember when he and Michael had a similar thing happen? Look at that. Lots
now,
of luck.
Now watch, though.
He's got the clutch in, though.
He can't turn the car around otherwise. But look what he did, just like he was on water or on the snow, and lit perfectly. Now that's really some credit.
Remember, he used to be able to do that on those Formula One tracks where the guardrails are on both sides of narrow streets. He had room here, but he showed his skill.
Not that I'm suggesting he should retire, but should he ever, he's got a place as a stunt driver. There's no question about it.
Well, you know, Paul Newman raced in the Trans Am the other day. He's 68, and he said to Mario, I did okay. Mario said, you know, I think that just extended my career 10 years.
Now look at all four wheels are locked up. Now watch him kick the clutch. He revs the engine up, pops the clutch. He knows where to quicken. He releases the brake, releases the power. Now he takes off again. I'm telling you, that guy knew exactly what he's trying to do. And he's also, he was in desperation.
Yeah,
that's going.
Kind of a bootleg turn. He'd be good at parallel parking or, you know, escaping the run runners.
I'll tell you what. The officials have looked over that one, scratched their heads, checked the rule book, and they say it's legal. No problem. So thankfully, they can affect that repair, Jack.
Now, Paul, this will put Robbie Gordon completely out of rotation for pit stops. But that is how bad the buffeting was on Robbie Gordon's helmet. He could not keep his head up, so they elected to come in early. And you can see they are throwing out the tape, and they are now making the change. They are going to wedge with racer's tape a big piece of foam rubber between his helmet and the right side. You can see them working feverishly there, trying to wedge it in. But more importantly than wedging it in, you've got to make sure that it's secure at 230 miles an hour. This tape is only rated at 200 miles an hour. Who knows if this fix is going to work or not?
Remember what Bobby Unser suggested at the start of the show. Every second he sits there is over 235 feet being gobbled up by the other race cars.
335 feet, Paul. And I'll tell you another thing. Robbie Gordon doesn't know if that's going to feel good on the track. It's a terrible time to try to do that.
Well, Robbie Gordon almost spins it coming out. Gary Gerald.
Here's an interesting shot in Emerson Fittipaldi's pits. He's been in and used so many tires, and because the load has changed on the car, they're building up rubber on the rear tires. So the engineers are now scraping that rubber off so that they can reuse the tires. He continues to have problems. He knows he can't win the race. He's just trying to hang in as long as he can to get as many points as he can.
Very bad development.
Saw the crew chief Tim Bumps look up there at Teddy Mayer, and they both kind of shrugged.
If you look at the tires, the front tires on this, it is running slow. They're picking up rubber. Look at the rubber building up on the tires. We watched Tracy coming in. Now, what happened when you see, look at the rubber build up on it there. When you see the car spinning.
Down here, what's
yeah,
that,
there's
Bobby
a flood.
Going?
There's oil coming out. Oil and water, oil or water, or both of them. Wow. That looks like water because that's where the radiator is.
I'd say then it isn't a tire problem, and where it stopped on the course,
that's
definitely bring out the yellow flag.
So what's happening to the guys when we see the tires being scraped there? They're scraping off the rubber, so when the guys leave the pits, they don't spin. Obviously, that's what spun Mario out, and you saw Robbie Gordon. You saw Robbie Gordon getting sideways there.
Still haven't decided for yellow. Now they make the decision. We're coming back to the green flag now. Rollo Boisel making a move on Mario Andretti. A battle for second place as they come back to the green flag. Rollo using what traffic he can. You look the angle back from Allister Jr.'s car, giving us good coverage there. But now Raul is able to drop in behind Allister Jr. And Mario is able to pull ahead as he drops in behind Olivier Grillard.
Now the restarts, these guys will turn the boost up to the max, plus put it in the low gear. Because traffic is one thing that makes it the most danger around here. The sooner they can get away from the other cars, the safer and the better for them.
Boisel back in contact now with Mario Andretti as the battle for second place heads down into the tri-oval and across the stripe. Nigel Mansell is unchallenged. He continues a full lap in the lead.
Boisel known as a consistent performer in previous years, but this year he has really come to the front, unhesitatingly racing the big superstar names in this sport.
All right, let's watch and listen as Raul Boisel tries to chase down Mario Andretti. Scott Goodyear just up to the right. He moved past Boisel. Boisel back past him. Now he's back just ahead of Boisel. We'll watch.
we saw little Al's kind of a while. Go back off about a quarter of a throttle in the dirt. But, like most of them are, but not Nigel Mansell.
So Raul Boisel working as hard as he can to try to get back up into combative position with the top of the field. You look out the back of Scott Goodyear's
that's
car.
Going to happen.
The nose of Rahal's car.
I know agrees with me. We've shared so many exciting moments this season looking out over the nose of Rahal's car. This is by far the closest approximation of any of our onboard cameras. You see little Al squeeze by him here that we have ever had. This is the feeling of being in the car.
But ironically, Sam, it still doesn't show how steep the banking really is here. A person almost has to stand down the racetrack to appreciate how steep the banks are here at Michigan. What the drivers go through, but this camera certainly gets the closest to it I've ever seen.
Are you in agreement with that, Sam? So you guys are now in total agreement on something. This is great. Here comes Scott Brayton as he comes up to overhaul Bobby Rahal. It is a fight for ninth place, and Scott Brayton has him. Brayton gets past Rahal.
I think the law of averages caught up with Bobby, and he was right.
Sooner or later it had to happen, no doubt. Yeah. Al Unser Jr.'s normal teammate would be Danny Sullivan and would normally be running here, but Sullivan's car, which was practiced with by Adrian Fernandez, was withdrawn. Sullivan had the flu, had it so severe that they had IV fluids, intravenous fluids, flowing on him on Friday just to get some of his body fluids back.
Now here's little Al again later in the race with a telemetry at the bottom of the screen, 100% down the front straightaway. Let's watch what he does in the turns, 51%, 42. Now that's better ball than before. He was getting down to 24 and 30% on the throttle before. That's the throttle opening. His RPM is up a little bit, so he's gotten the car handling better. He's running harder now than he did earlier on.
All right, let's just sit right here with Al Unser Jr. as he closes on another car and watch and listen.
And just realize for a split second that Danny Sullivan is probably watching this from his home in Aspen and thinking about what it would be like to be in this race.
Now we'll listen.
See his groove and how he's reacting to it. The throttle percentage really tells us how much horsepower he's putting out.
And Bobby, the interesting thing is he's able to hold it at 100% throttle longer now than when we rode with him earlier in the race. So his handling has definitely improved.
We'll continue to listen. Every now and then you hear the song of Goodyear coming through there too as the tires kind of squeal on the pavement as he turns into the corner. Possibility for a team expansion, by the way. Gary Fear, Nigel Mansell will be the leader of the race. Mario Andretti come out in second place. Tail Bobby comes in and gets a flag to go. You caught a glimpse of Bobby Rahal, who did the same. So everyone should theoretically, Bobby, be in proper position now to run all the way to the end of the race. We'll take a look at the running order right now.
I've just run my figures on it, Paul, and they can both go to the end of the race right now if they don't use any more than what they have in the past. Nigel and Mario both gone 38 and 39 laps respectfully, and so they shouldn't have any problem, believe me. They'll be close to out the end.
And so with this yellow, Mario has closed up, so he is going to come behind Nigel Mansell as they come back to the green flag, and green flag racing once again. The green is out. We're racing. Mario Andretti is going to do everything he can to close on his teammate. There's plenty of traffic right there. Mario is just behind Rahal. Willing to rip, runs down low. Into the first corner, Mario selects a high line, comes around ribs, continues his pursuit of Mansell.
Traffic playing such a big part of this.
Jr. Mario trying to close.
Remember, there isn't a driver out there that's going to make it easy on you.
Nigel Mansell setting up behind Raul Boissel, who at speed is very, very quick on this circuit. Boissel is fourth. Lyon-Dyke is third.
Mansell had to get out of the throttle there as he came up behind Boissel. You see it's killed his momentum for a moment. Watch as he begins his counterattack.
This is the kind of thing that can cost Mansell in these closing laps of the race. Anytime he gets involved with traffic, he would love to get clear of all this so that he can deal with Mario on his own terms.
Do you mean the inexperience, Paul, because of not having run these high banks ever before, or the question of being blocked? Here comes Mario ripping by Rahal.
Simply the question of being blocked. I think inexperience is something that attaches to Nigel Mansell for about three laps, and then forget it. He knows exactly what's going on.
You can see how close Mario came to Rahal when he was drafted in trying to get by, using everything that he could get. Because they know they're going to have a shoot-off right at the end. Inside the screen, well, a little red on top of it. He can't even handle Boissel. Boissel has come back by him. And you can notice that Mario is not making it good through the turns. So the adjustments that they did in that last pit stop were obviously the wrong way.
Mario pushing way up toward the gray on all of the corners now.
Well, Bobby, we noticed that on Mario's last pit stop, when the crew was adjusting the front wings, you saw him waving frantically from the cockpit. It's not impossible. You see him try. Boissel on the high line. No, that's a gutsy move by Mario.
Mario stays right in there in traffic. Got up as close to the wall as I care to get.
Now, who would think you'd have this close to the flash?
Boy, that is really taking a deep breath.
Boissel got captured right on the bottom. Mario took a big risk going on top, and he made it.
Mario is about 8 seconds behind Mansell. He had to do that or just forfeit the race. We have less than 15 minutes of racing to go. You see Carl Haas, he switched ends on the cigar there. Obviously, that's all he could do in terms of technical adjustment.
Roberto Guerrero comes in once again. Remember, he's been stopping the entire day off of the regular sequence, so this is really a routine stop for Roberto and will be the last in his race. Let's get an update now from Jack Arruth.
Well, Paul, Mario is a 1kg driver. Remember, we just saw that move where he split with Raul Boissel. In the driver's meeting, they were discussing what lapped race traffic should do. Many of the drivers said, stay low. Mario raised his hand and said, I think it would be better if the lap traffic stayed in the middle groove. That way, if you're racing for position, one driver could go high, one driver could go low. In the case of Yogi Berra, maybe it was deja vu for Mario all over again.
Oh, boy. I think it's easy to talk about tactics and strategy, but it's quite another thing to execute a maneuver like Mario just did. I think in a sense, you know, he's fighting today for a bit of family honor. His son, Michael, has become an object almost of derision to the European press, elements of the U.S. press, too. And I think that Mario's pole position yesterday and now this brilliant performance today, boy, it puts the Andretti name right up in the headlines again.
Here's Mario's move just a moment ago through traffic. We looked at it once again.
That was
four abreast.
That was really a calculated pass by Mario. A lot of luck. The drivers did go where he needed them to go.
As he continues his fight the tail.
Now he's getting up. Well, he's past the draft. He's going to drive right on by.
Fight for fifth place. Goodyear takes it back. So the adjustment to the engine, because they're carrying more fuel, he can now make more power and he can race.
Well, he certainly got by tail pretty fast and pretty nice there.
Remember that at this moment last year, Scott Goodyear was on his way to victory in this race. Disappointed a little bit by this performance, but it's been a very solid race for him. Interesting, the turning of the tie. Penske 1-2 in the last two races. There's Paul Newman with Carl Haas. The Penske team now not strong in this race at all. The Newman-Haas team running 1-2. So the two great teams of this year, Penske and Newman-Haas, have swapped positions, so to speak, today. Newman-Haas back on top.
Nigel Mansell, if he takes this win, and it looks like he may move back to the head of the points fight. Nigel giving it everything he has, still running laps at 221 miles an hour.
Isn't it nice to see Paul Newman like racing as much as he likes it? Here he is, one of the best actors in the world. He likes motor racing better than he does his acting.
Well, watch as much of our show, incidentally, in the early stages of the race back in the motorhome, and then comes out and tells everybody what he's learned.
So red number five, Nigel Mansell, makes the turn off turn now, and this time around he should see the white flag. There it is, 2 miles, one more lap to go. Will this make up for the Indianapolis 500? Certainly not in purse, but it may prove something both to Nigel and to his fans. He can indeed win at 500 miles on the backstretch. Just 1 mile to go now. Nigel Mansell on his way to his third win as a rookie. He's won on a road course. He's won on a mile oval. And now as he turns toward home, Nigel Mansell has won on a super speedway and won the Michigan 500.
Quite a good job by Nigel all day long.
And a 1-2 finish for Newman Haas as Mario Andretti flashes across the line in second place. Ari Leyendyke turns for home in third place. Raul Boisel in fourth. And Scott Goodyear still occupying fifth that he just took away from Tao Fabi.
You can just imagine Roger Penske's feelings when these guys came and took his playhouse away from him here today. Really a good show for the Fords. Unfortunately, not too good for Chevrolet today.
And there's the Newman Haas team as Mario Andretti comes up and waves his congratulations to red number 5, Nigel Mansell, the winner of the Michigan 500, and a thumbs up from Al Unser Jr. too. They do like this guy, and they love to race against him. Gary Gerald is in the Newman Haas pits.
Well, Jim McGee, final conversation to his man. How about this rookie in this IndyCar business, Jim? You got to just shake your head in amazement.
Yeah, he is. He's amazing. You know, the team did a heck of a job. You know, the Kmart Texaco car really ran super all day. Both cars, and, you know, with Mario's great finish in qualifying, it's been a great day for Newman Haas.
Indeed it has. Get to victory lane.
Thank you. Thank
all
you.
Right. Paul?
You know, there's a guy, Jim McGee, that was with Bobby Rahal, ran his team last year. I just get to thinking that maybe they're missing him right now, Paul.
So Nigel Mansell leads 222 of 200. Second place, Mario Andretti, smiling, happy, non-pulsed at the completion of this event. He finished 9 seconds behind Nigel Mansell. Mansell, on the other hand, has not yet climbed out of the race car. As a matter of fact, his team is hovering around him. They've been pouring water on his head, giving him a drink of water. He is totally exhausted at the end of the day. Let's consider the difference in ages between these two guys.
14 years older than Nigel, but evidently the effects on Nigel were a great deal greater.
Now, of course, Mario's done this before. This is Nigel's first win.
Well, a lot of show biz with Nigel, but he's an awfully good race driver. He certainly went fast today, but I do like to see the Mario being that much older. Looks like he could run another 500 miles, and Nigel doesn't look like he could have made it the last 400.
Well, Mario Andretti finished second. We'll give Nigel a few minutes to recover and go to Gary Gerald, who's with Mario.
Mario, they're commenting here as you talk with your crew about how remarkably fresh you look. You've put in 500 grueling miles. You've got a few years on some of these other guys in here, and yet you look like you held up very, very well.
Well, I guess I'm thankful for that, obviously. I work at it pretty hard, and I take pride in that. I think it's very important, especially, as I say, at my age, I don't want to give anything to the youngsters physically anyway. And I'm tired, of course. My arms are ready to fall off, but we're still okay.
Tell us quickly about that incident coming out of the pit stop when you looped it around and then you made that bootleg turn, kept it running. The crowd was standing, screaming, and you saved yourself a lot of discomfort and maybe great embarrassment.
Yeah, well, of course. But to get out of the pits were so tight, I had to turn really sharp to miss Nigel's tire. And then when I whipped it the other way, there was absolutely no grip. And there are two patches, and it caught me out. I just didn't have enough lock, you know, to catch it back. And I figured, oh, boy. But kept the engine running, and then I figured, well, as easily as it spun this way, I know I can spin it the other way. So
high drama on pit road. Congratulations, Mario.
Thank you.
Jack?
Well, Gary, it's just typical. Once you get the adrenaline and it starts to settle, you come into victory lane, it all begins to fall around you. But, Nigel, first of all, I know you're exhausted, but congratulations. 500-mile victory, your first.
It's just fantastic, and all credit to the team. The team did just a fantastic job, and I lost a lot of my readouts on the dashboard, and I was relying very strongly on the team and Jim McGee to give me the information, and I'm just so happy. It's a fantastic victory for all the sponsors. But I tell you, I don't mind admitting I'm bushed. I'm tired.
This is only the second 500 miler for you. Is this more exhausting than your outing at Indianapolis?
I've never felt so rough. Personally, I feel real tired. And, you know, the track's a great track, but it does, as Mario said, it does beat you down, and I'm beat now.
Well, you've run practically every great world racing facility, the current world driving champion. How does a 500-mile race now compare to your efforts in Formula One in the past?
I've never been in anything like it in my life, and I'd like to congratulate Roger Penske on this. You know, the layout of the circuit is fantastic. It's so different to Indianapolis. It stands on its own. I mean, two great 500-milers, and I'm just happy I won this one.
And you got the points lead back.
Yeah, that's all credit to the team. I mean, the team just did a wonderful, wonderful job.
Well, a little bit of a cloud cover has come over. We're going to let you try and get your stamina back. Congratulations, Nigel. Let's check in with my colleague, Gary Gerald, with more news.
Indeed. Here's Ari Lyandike, a third-place finish. And this was a tough ride for you because right from the green flag today, you had problems early that were forcing you back in the field, and you really had to play catch-up all day long.
Well, right from the beginning, you know, I attacked there in the first corner and immediately was repassed by Nigel. And from there on, the car really pushed bad. The front end washed out all the time. And I had to get out of the throttle, so that really cost me, you know, speed. And that I was fighting that pretty much all day, even at the end. And, you know, finishing third is great. The Target Scotch video team did a good job. But, you know, we were third, but there were a lot of people that were quicker than us, but they had their own problems. My crew did a great job in the pits. We didn't have any problems with, you know, wrong timing on the yellow flags. That also helped us a little bit, so... We're third today, and we're happy with it.
Something about Ari Lyandike and super speedways that mix very, very nicely. You're always strong in these 500-milers.
Well, I wish I would have been a little bit stronger today because Newman Haas team was really in a class of their own, and it would have been a lot more fun to be able to compete with them.
Now let's find out also.